Okay, so Dhaka, Bangladesh, is a city of 15 to 17 million people, and it's in a plain surrounded by a number of rivers. And everybody knows a lot about Bangladesh as a place that floods quite frequently, and flooding is a serious concern. But geologists have identified, looking through historical records and also the geology of the area, that there's some very, very large, significant faults that underlie the whole area of Bangladesh and particularly the city of Dhaka. And so these faults, which are deep underground, have in recent times, the last 150, 200 years, triggered very large earthquakes. The underlying concern has been that if one of these earthquakes were to occur and Dhaka would be affected, then there would be quite a lot of damage. And the government itself estimates close to 100,000 people might die in a very bad earthquake there. And thousands of more injured, and lots of property damage and difficulties of surviving. So what we were looking at in the simulation was what could international organizations, non-governmental organizations, NGOs, and local community neighborhood groups do together with the government to try to prepare for this massive earthquake that might occur. But our focus was not on the immediate relief, the saving of people from collapsed buildings, but more on what would come in the weeks after the earthquake. So we talked about in the simulation these different challenges, how to provide water and food, not in the immediate aftermath of a disaster, but for the next 6 months or 12 months or 18 months that it will take people to recover from the disaster. One thing that was very important that we identified was that some 80% of the people in Dhaka are renters of housing, which means if their housing is damaged, their apartment or their house is damaged, then they're going to have a hard time finding another place to rent a house. Once rental space, apartments are damaged, it's very hard to make new apartment buildings quickly. It takes years. And Dhaka has been building for decades, building apartment houses and places for people to live. And it's going to take decades to replace those if they're damaged. So you have to figure out ahead of time how you're going to house and provide safe accommodations, water and sanitation and other things, in a very short period of time. I mean, that's one of the challenges in Dhaka is that you have a high, relatively high and relatively low-income people living right next to each other. Oftentimes, the lower-income people are kind of hidden from official view or from day-to-day life. You don't necessarily realize there are that many people living as maids or cleaning people or guards or other workers. You know, you have a bunch of people living in apartment houses, but then there are all these other people living in the same buildings. How do you support them? They're not necessarily part of the official census, all simply because the transport's quite complicated, quite difficult. They don't come from far away. They live near where they work. And so they may live in a squatter settlement in an unused piece of land, an unused property, or they may even live in a partially constructed building. The simulation is probably best used in the case of Dhaka as a way of perfecting and demonstrating that people have learned things that they've been taught previously. So if we take the issue of shelter separately, you'd want to do some planning, some training of people on how to deal with shelter, and then use a simulation to see if they've learned that and what gaps they might have, what further learning might be useful, and also to think through how plans and preparedness are being developed in the shelter area. So you have a live simulation in which people actually are painted up to look like they're harmed by the earthquake, and they have, looks like they have broken bones and things like that, and so that you simulate the emergency requirements and how to save people and things like that. Certainly there's an issue if there was flooding, if it was during the flooding season, the monsoon, and there was an earthquake that occurred at the same time, the damages could be much worse. The use of the simulation process in Bangladesh and preparing for the big earthquake that's expected really should also come from looking at how organizations are working together. So, and the simulation is a great way to test that work together. Do they know who to call? How do they deal with problems? Because simulations usually present problems that are sometimes quite complex, and you want to see how people deal with this. So the simulation itself can test things, but also is a learning opportunity, both for the organizations that hold it, but also for the individuals who participate, because it's the next best thing to having a disaster. But there's been relatively little planning so far on what to do in the weeks and months after the disaster, how to get the markets and commercial systems back in operation, taking care of the housing issue, water and other kinds of things over the long term. And so that's why we had the simulation, was because it's the next step in the planning that the government and its partners need to do to prepare for the earthquake.